And now, a message from the producer.
Hello. And thank you for buying the logger video. What you'll be watching on this video is two separate stories about two different trips to New York City. One trip I took 2 years ago. I went down there with my friend Little. My then wife had won two free tickets off from the radio station. I'll be telling you this story on stage at the Vergennes Opera House in Vergennes, Vermont. The other trip I took back in May. I'll be telling you this story right there on the streets of Manhattan, right on the New York City streets. And I'll introduce you to some friends that I met while I was down there. Two separate stories about two different trips to New York City. Two stories on the same tape. What a bargain. So, I'm gonna rewind it here for you. Why don't you go grab yourself a Pop-Tart, come on back in relaxed, and enjoy the show. Cinnamon frosted. I wanted to tell you about my trip to New York and other things. Store. The man was tall, lean, mean, green-eyed, and light-colored. He stood like one of them fellas that looks like they like wearing a badge and a name tag. Airport customs agent. Bruce. Uniform cleaned and pressed so neatly. Shine shoes, gun, leash, dog, beagle. Dope-sniffing beagle. I'd never seen a dope-sniffing dog before. Did I ever tell you that my wife makes scented candles? Yeah, she took first prize ribbon last year up to the Barton Fair for longest burning. My favorites is the ones that smell like succotash. I can't for the life of me understand how she gets wax to smell like corn and lima beans. But anyway, she'd packed my bag for the trip, two undershirts, two underpants, extra pairs of socks, toothbrush, box of good and plenties, and 2 dozen scented candles. Why don't you go ahead, take a wild guess whose bag that dope-sniffing dog headed straight for? Started sniffing cute beagle anyway. I hunched down to shag its ears when I felt the hand of the law come down on my neck hard, and I heard a pistol cock. Cease petting that dog at once. It's United States government property. I dared to peer up at him, and his head was one great big giant raw nerve ending all a-twitching, and there was fluid seeping out from around his eye sockets. Minute after hour, after day, after month, he trundles that airport baggage claim, just praying for something to happen. Well, I guess he must have taken one look at me and Little and figured he'd found himself a couple of country boys with a bag full of homegrown, and it didn't take me long to realize that we was what he thought he had been praying for to happen. So I ceased petting immediate, but that dog kept sniffing, 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 getting that dog nose slime crap and shit all over my bag, you know? I said,
What the hell's he doing? He's attempting to detect an illegal substance with his olfactory. Stand clear. I said there ain't no legal substances in there. Them is scented candles, for Christ's sake. And I no sooner started back into petting when that agent pointed his pistol at my temple and bellowed attack, to which that dog turned on its heels and started biting the bejesus out of my leg. I had a loaded gun pointed at my head here. I had a dog biting the Christ out of my leg there. I looked back up to Little for help. Do something, Little. He looked down at me and farted. Lindo! Succotash. Twas a fear fart. Them hot, stinky ones that come at bad times without warning due to excessive nervousness. Like during the hill stop portion of your driver's test. Or when having the first kiss of a girl you got a real big crush on. Or when meeting your beloved's parents for the very first time. Oh, Mrs. Johnson, I see where Becky gets her pretty eyes. Well, must be that fart smelled better than them scented candles, because the dog headed right over to Lidl's britches. And when he did, I said, see, he's got the drugs in his underwear. Diverted that agent's attention, I took off. Little followed me. We run like catamounts all the way into Manhattan.
Central Park, they rent these little ice skates. Got little dinky tires on them, you know. Probably help me get around quicker in the long run. That's if I don't get matted by one of them yellow cabs they got around here, or one of them kneeling buses they got for the old people and the cripples. You got a lot of old people and cripples around here, I noticed. Of course, they got a lot of old people and cripples everywhere, but around here, there's a lot of them. Tough going for them. I probably do all right on these rigs. I used to watch Nudge Come and Each on the Wide World on Sunday afternoons, you know, growing up in winter. Get all psyched up, head out the frog pond, do triple cell kills, break my behind, you know. If I like these things too, I can't tie this for nothing. There we go. If I like them, I think I'll get a pair of these for my friend George. He ain't got an electric gutter cleaner in his barn. I think if he put these on, he'd go whizzing around and clean the crap in a hurry. Of course, if you're gonna use these in your barn, you're gonna wanna get little Hakapalitas, because the tires that come from the factory on this is treadless. Smooth. I'm headed. Central Park Gym, free of charge. Limber, headed out the streets. Kids, don't try this at home, though. No helmet. Try it at school. No, don't try it. Don't. Y'all darn get a bunch of trouble for that from the school teachers and stuff. I don't need to wear a helmet, because I'm dumber than a brick anyway. Ain't nothing going to hurt me if I fall, you know. Like, of course, I'm smart enough. I like to say I'm smart. I like to say what I am is I'm Walmart smart. I got a lot in the store, but ain't none of it worth a shit. No. Anyways, I'm headed. Hey, right over there, smack dab, is where they put that Rockefeller Center Christmas tree. Every Christmas, 75-foot Norwegian spruce to kill it. Dead tree. They take the oxygen right out of the air for us. They always lie in the papers. They say, oh, it was going to die anyway. It had Japanese beetle stuck up in it. You know, and the people that cut it down off from their property, they say, oh, we're so happy to have our tree at the Rockefeller Center for Christmas time for the millions of people to enjoy. They've killed a 75-foot beautiful tree. Why don't they get smart? Do what Herb taught me to do. My friend Herb, I go out on my property, see this big, great, big, I find a great big white pine, take my 30-06, kill, take top right off it, about 7-8 foot there. Drops the ground, I got myself a Christmas tree. You ain't killed the white pine, you've severely injured it badly, but it'll fluff up in about 10 years and you're pruning, really, is all you're doing. You're gun pruning. Pruning with a gun. You can do it. Go around pruning trees, you can do a business. Gun pruning. Loggers gun pruning services. You go around pruning the arborvitaes and
Got down apple trees for the lady, and then you go up the door and knock on it and say, "Hi, lady, I'm done pruning. Where's your money?" Everything's a spectacle in New York. Loud, big, money, everything. Except for that skating rink down there. That Rockefeller Center skating rink ain't very big. Take a look at it, ain't no bigger than my dinky pond I learned on when I was a boy back then. You got Elga Cabot there and all darn Brian Botano skating around there. I learned back 1971. Center. Look at him go. Look at that fella.
We run like catamounts all the way into Manhattan, where I let flicker with two dimes and a nickel and called my friend Stevie Campbell. Stevie Campbell, the son of Mr. Ward Campbell, the veterinarian doctor. He started as a veterinarian who made house calls, then found that as he was veterinarianing into a cat, dog, or guinea pig, he'd look around the living room there and see that the human being sitting there was generally two or three times sicker looking than their pets was. So he started to doctor into the humans, got pretty good at it, went down Montpelier, took the doctor's test, passed. That's why ever since we've called him Mr. Ward Campbell, the veterinarian doctor. Who, so far as I know, is the only person of the medical cloth who can at the same house call be fertilizing your prize heifer with this hand while tending to your mother-in-law's goiter with the other. Then the day he experimented with dental doctoring, you know old gummy bear Kaiser. She's got that arthritic hip. She's a regular stop on the veterinarian doctor's rounds. Her first name, gummy bear, because she ain't got no teeth. And it twa'n't that they rotted her, got knocked out or anything. It's just that after she lost her baby teeth, her adult ones never come back in. Weird. Of course, she does have an extra pinky on her right hand. You know Lonnie Smith. He's a couple stops before gummy bears. Well, seems old Lonnie's best woods horse, Stanley, couldn't chew corn. Had a mouthful of aching choppers, he did. Lubed to the gills, the veterinarian doctor extracted every one of them horse teeth, made one hell of a set of dentures, affixed them into gummy bear's mouth, and now if gummy bear is even the slightest bit amused, you can see her coming from 2 miles off. Poor old girl got to use login chain for dental floss. Want to keep a good eye on her, too, because she'll fall asleep standing up. Sounds like a bad joke, but you think about it. You got an arthritic hip, falling asleep standing up be a pain in the ass. Being a double dipper has garnered the veterinarian doctor quite a dinner pail full of change, which has allowed his son, Stevie Campbell, the opportunity to live in New York City.
And where are we? What's the area we are at?
We are at Rockefeller Center. Radio City Music Hall.
Radio City Music
Hall. McGraw Hill Building.
That's McGraw Hill Building. These four buildings are...
All Rockefeller Center.
Who's in there? What are they doing?
Oh, you got Time Inc. in one of these buildings. Time Warner. McGraw Hill. Making books.
What are you... Where are you from, by the way?
Vermont. Stowe, Vermont.
Get the hell out of here. You're from Vermont.
I am, so. I got documentation.
9 million people here.
Driver's license still from Vermont.
And everything. We pick a Vermont guy to do it. Well, I don't believe you're from Vermont looking like you do. Gall darn pink tie on. I got a question. I'll give you a test.
Alrighty.
What's bumper hitching?
Grab a hold of the bumper and ride with it.
In the snow.
In the snow.
You got it. God darn guy is from Vermont.
Of a truck.
I can't believe that. It's interesting. Well, let me ask you this then. What the hang are you doing here? Where do you work?
Work up here in the NBC building for Venture Capital Fund.
What's Venture Capital?
It's a group of us. We look for interesting companies to invest in, buy, work with the management. Companies that can grow quickly.
Ben and Jerry's, perhaps.
Ben and Jerry's could have been one. Didn't get that one.
Is that one you could have really bought?
Could have. Didn't know about that one.
Well, we wish you did, because some of the Vermont people ain't quite so happy about
that. You
don't
think
so? Unibee.
No, no, no.
No, they're not.
Really? Okay.
That's too bad old Eric didn't get a hold of that.
That's right.
Let's get this guy in here. You don't want to come in here?
Come on in there. How you doing?
Sir guy.
Where are you from?
Pakistan.
Pakistan? Hey, you're here on vacation?
No.
You live here?
Yes.
Well, what's your name?
Wasim.
Wasim? My name's the logger. Nice to meet you, one. See? Nice fella. See you later. Oh, you want to come
guys,
in here?
Guys, have a nice day.
Come on up here.
Get up.
Come on up.
Get up.
Look at that little cox. Ain't he something now?
There she is.
Now, I'm not going to ask you what you make for money.
Because
that's a rude question to ask. I wanted to know, like, some Wall Street people or something, for bonuses, just for bonuses. If you're on Wall Street, you're a 40-year-old guy, what are you getting at Christmas for bonus?
Could, if it's a good year, they might get $200,000, $250,000.
For bonus. You kidding me?
Less, they get less salary than bonus. But maybe even...
Oh, that's a big worry. I remember I got a bonus one time at Christmas. I was packing hams, and they was giving turkeys away. Got around to me, they run out of turkeys. They gave me 3 guinea hens and a table talk pumpkin pie. Ridiculous.
Kidnap my kid.
Okay, old Jacques over there. We'll give him back.
That's all right.
You're going to be famous.
All right.
No problem.
Nice. All right. See you later.
Take care.
Then what would someone pay for a one-room bedroom apartment? One room, one bedroom.
Probably about $2,000 to $2,500 a month.
You better be earning.
Going up.
You better be earning $200,000 running bonus if you're paying that. Well, it's nice talking to you.
Nice talking to you.
Let you get back to work. We don't want you to be short when the guinea hens are coming around, you know, Christmas time. Appreciate it. All right.
No problem at all.
Yeah, we'll see you when you're up in Stowe.
All righty.
All
see
right.
you later.
Yep. City, you ought to be up the farm. You're a fine fella. Fine fella. They feeding you enough grain? Huh? Huh? How the ladies treat you? How the... Hey, Bo. How the ladies treating you? You getting after them? Looks like you're having a good time here in New York City. Everybody comes down here and has their picture taken right smack in front of this bull's face. But they don't take no pictures at this end. Look at them there. Shined up, bemmer testicles, ain't they? Large ones. My friend Eric Sherman, we met up there, that businessman, he gave me a bunch of business terms that I could learn and study up on so I could try business when I get back home, get to be rich. Gross. That's what my wife says when she gets into a big blackhead on my back. Net. That's what my wife puts on her head after the Dan Rather news every night. Microsoft. That's what happens to my wiener after my wife puts her net on. Post-depression era. That's the time from when my wife and I first consummated our relationship until now. On the same page. That's what President Clinton and Ted Kennedy are. Graduate school. What I didn't do. 1099. That's what my wife's wedding ring cost me. Yen. I don't know what the hang yen is. Ruble. Barney's last name. High yield bond. A high yield bond is a relationship between two heifers that give off a lot of milk. FOMC, see note. Each letter is the first letter to a word. Example, United States of America. FOMC, farmers own many cows, flies on many cows, flies on McCann, fire out McCann, full of macaroni and cheese. Fat ones might croak, I know. If you're full of macaroni and cheese, fat ones might croak, but not me, because there's fire out my can. Yes, I'm gone. FOMC is the Federal Open Market Committee. The Federal Open Market Committee is the official policy-setting panel of the Fed. Its voting members are the 7 governors of the Federal Reserve Board and the presidents of 5 of the 12 Federal Reserve banks. The FOMC controls 2 short-term interest rates, the federal funds rate, which is the rate that banks charge each other for loans, and the discount rate, which is the interest that the Feds charge banks when they borrow money back from the government securities they own. What do you think I am, stupid? Look at that, right there. Put one right on there. Watch it. Vermont is for lovers. Being a double dipper has garnered the veterinarian doctor quite a dinner pail full of change, which has allowed his son, Stevie Campbell, the opportunity to live in New York City and try to become a television actor, which has proved futile up to now, but has made him familiar enough with the city
So that when me and Little called him, said we was hungry and we would like to try eating at one of them fancy-dancy New York City restaurants, he knew right where we could head. So's we headed. Stevie had a friend who knew of a place, and that it was so fancy, the friend said that the desserts come with directions. We come up to it, and you could tell right off that it was a nice place because it was named after a French feller. And it wasn't after old Fidel Lacasse, the best dowser in West Danville, neither. It was named after a feller, and they called him Al Fresco. Well, I read the menu. They had taped to the window there, aloud, so Little knew what they were serving. They had it written in American words underneath the French ones, the only French word I understand being fromage, which means cheese, and I tried to stay the hell away from fromage because it binds me, you know. Well, I didn't think I need to be walking down the streets of New York City on my vacation all bound up, you know. That and mincemeat. I cannot take mincemeat because I repeat it. Yeah. And you put the two of them things together, forget about it. It's a goddamn tug of war between North and South. Let me put it to you this way. Dunking meatballs into cheese fondue is not my idea of a night out. But we thought that the rest of the entries looked a small amount better than Fare de Midland, so we started in. But before I stepped foot in, there was two things struck me about that menu. Down the bottom was a paragraph entitled Environmental Suggestions. The use of cellular phones interferes with the preparation of risotto. Please try and avoid cigar smoking and violent sexy perfumes. The second thing struck me about that menu was there weren't no prices on it. Then we stepped foot in, and we was greeted by a French feller wearing a penguin suit with a black bow tie.
Bonjour.
I would like to sit down free.
You do not have reservations?
No, just won't eat here as anywhere.
No. You do not have reservations.
No. Just then I look around and see two Richie-type New York City couples greeting each other. The proud, smiling men shook hands, and the women kissed each other on each cheek, one time each. And when they did, there wasn't even touching no skin or nothing. Instead, they was just kissing off and into the air there. And funny thing is, when they was doing it, they wasn't even looking at who they was kissing. Instead, they was looking back and off and into the restaurant, you know, as if to see if they could find the raincoat they left there the week before, you know. Well, one of them ladies was my cup of tea, and I had to chuckle to myself because I thought, if you give me a chance to kiss your cheek, Mrs. Jones, you're gonna know about that. Because I will kiss that one there, peck that one there, give them bottom to a good grab and heft, and we're walking. I'm telling you that right now. The one lady said to the other,
Kathy, them earrings, I'd kill for them earrings.
Kathy said, but Jan, that outfit you have on tonight is to die for. I parried myself. Well, I guess you ladies is in pretty good shape then. They looked at me. Well, Jan, if you'd kill to have them earrings, and Kathy, if you'd die to have that outfit, seems so to me, Jan, if you pulled out your revolver, plugged Kathy one in the head, you'd both be happy. They didn't think it was funny. That's just it, though. Right then and there, I figured it. How come them rich New York City people got all that stress? Too much tricky talking. You hear a lot of, oh, your car is wonderful. Isn't the salad fabulous? Oh, mine is marvelous. Puffy, but don't you think this restaurant is just simply so much fun? Well, restaurants aren't so much fun, nor are cars wonderful, salads fabulous, or marvelous. They all, however, can be one thing. They all can be beauties. Oh, your car's a beauty. Isn't the salad a beauty? Mine's a beauty. Oh, Buffy, but don't you think this restaurant's just simply a beauty? Yeah. You imagine sitting down noon Sunday dinner. Grandmama, but these biscuits you have prepared are simply to die for. No, we say, Gram, these rolls is beauties. Try it with me. Grandmama, but these biscuits you have prepared are simply to die for. Okay, put your hand here now, and you're being taped. Grandmama, but these biscuits you have prepared are simply to die for. Don't get to give you a headache. Now try, Gram, these rolls is beauties. Okay, do this on beauties. All right, ready, here we go. Gram, these rolls is beauties. No headache there. That lady just plugged her husband. A good one right there. But you will get a little twinge of something if you put wicked before it, like, Graham, these rolls is wicked beauty. See, a little bit too tricky, but if you put a cuss word before both of them, cancels it all out. Like, Graham, these rolls is goddamn wicked beauty. See, nothing there. Because cuss words are stress relievers. You see, rich people don't know that because they don't cuss. Well, they cuss, but they do it at home, private, behind closed doors with their family, because they don't want you and me to know that they cuss. However, what they don't realize is cuss words are stress relievers only when used in public. Right? Like the old Vermonter comes down to the filling station, middle of the town, middle of the day, Horace, goddamn dollar, 49 a gallon, Jesus, H. Christ, somebody's getting rich, ain't they? Well, fill up the son of a whore anyway. I gotta go to the dump, you know. Now that's effective cussing. When's the last time you heard of an old Vermonter dying of too much stress, climbing up the top of the silo? Martha, I love you and the kids. Don't happen. Happens all the time in New York City, because you will never hear Jan walk into that restaurant. Kathy, them earrings, I'd kill for them friggin' bastards. Well, Frenchie didn't think there's going to be room enough to set us, even after I assured him that neither one of us three had a cellular phone, nor did we smoke cigars, and contrary to what he might have thought, that odor that he smelt coming from Lido wasn't a violent, sexy perfume, but that it was probably pig shit stuck to his mutlocks. So he pointed us to the door, but before I stepped foot out and turned on my heels, could I ask you a question?
Oui?
No, thank you, I'm fine, but... I was wondering, that menu of yours didn't have no prices on it. Does that mean if there'd have been room to set us down here in Etten, that we could have eaten here for nothing?
No. That means that you could not eat here at all. Au revoir.
Boy. Yeah, I ate at one of them fancy restaurants last night. Prices just about freak you out, you know. I had a scallop dinner. $33.50 scallops, 5 of them, no big round nickels. You know, you go up Hardwick Diner, the Plum and Main and Johnson there, you order the scallop dinner. Big round your fist, I think they get them out of the Elmore Lake here in the morning. It's $11, $10.50, scallops. I had a cruller, homemade, from the Hardwick Diner, 75-cent homemade cruller. Over at the Plum and Main, you get a short stack of pancakes for $2.25, peppered with blueberries. $2.25, I'm telling you. That's a good deal. I had the dessert. The tiramisu, that ain't Timmy Suey Tui. I don't know what the hell it is. Come about big rounds and overall growing radish, you know. And they got this cream around the sides to give you a vertigo so you don't see what you ain't getting. $11.50 for the tiramisu. Hardwick Diner, homemade donut, 75 cents, packed full of jelly. Plum and Main Restaurant in Johnson, chocolate cream pie big enough to sink your canoe there. Not even $3 for that. If you want to get a dessert at the fancy restaurant, order up the sac de bonbon, $25.50. Sac de bonbon, $25.50. That'll do it. It's an awful thing, though. You don't want to get anywhere near that. $33.50 for the scallop dinner, $11.50 for the tiramisu. You add them together, that's $33, and then $10, that's $43. Put another one on that, it's $44, and take the 50s and put them together, there's one. $45, double that if you got a date. $90, take that, put a down payment on your house trailer. Because it ain't worth the food, and I'll tell you why. Them fancy places fill you full of fancy stuff like garlic. They had currants on my scallop plate. I kept running around trying to get them back onto the plate, you know, little green cabbages. And not only that, but paprika on top of it. This makes you sneeze, and it ain't cinnamon. No, and I went to the lavatory there to wash my hands. It's stuff that a Vermonter don't need. And it makes you sick to your stomach. I went in that lavatory, smelled like someone been spreading liquid fertilizer in there. Wow! I come back to my plate there. I eat it down, I got the waiter over, and I said, you should have labeled this with the hazardous material label, because I'm sick to my stomach. I went home to my apartment, headed down over to the stool pot, sat right down on it, and spackled it. Spackled it. Turned it right into a Jackson Pollock painting, all over the place, instantly. I'm telling you, the guy that I was renting the apartment from that night, he come in, went into the bathroom after me. He come out yelling, who did the decoupage? Who did the decoupage? I'm telling you, it was maddened. Wallpaper in the place. Awful.
paprika.
It's an awful thing. I didn't know I had that much fluid in me. I put that stream right down to me, all over the place. I learned something. We're eating Mexican food tonight, and I'm gonna go home right now and line the stool pot with fire brick.
Tain't no had feelings felt, you know, especially after the living mirage that we was just about to come upon. Do you have a favorite supermodel? I do. Cindy Crawford. I never ever thought I'd ever get a chance to meet her, but loggers luck, who in the hand you think we run into down there on the street on the sidewalk, but Cindy Crawford. I shook her hand, oh, hi, Miss Crawford, nice to meet you, you pretty, oh, I love your pictures. Yeah, I got your swimsuit calendar up on the wall in my shop, yeah. 1989 I wanted in a raffle. I mark the dates you knew on it every year. Oh, I'm big fan of yours, big fan. I'm from Vermont, don't you know? I always say that, it never fails to get them. And she looked me straight in the eye with that mole there, and I could tell by looking at her that she was just about getting ready to pounce onto me, you know? She had that glazed-eyed stare going, you know, the same one raccoons have when they got rabies. Of course, you don't want that look in a raccoon, but you want that look in Cindy Crawford. She said, you're from Vermont, huh? I said, yes, ma'am, indeed I am a green mountain boy. I can chop, split, and stack 6 cord in a day and still have enough energy left over to rent a video. She said, well, I'm here with the television crew. Could I ask you a question? Cindy, go right ahead. Hi, I'm Cindy Crawford here with MTV's House of Style. And we're here today doing an interview for PETA, People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals. And we wanted to ask this gentleman what he thought about little, tiny, small, furry, cuddly, comfy, harmless, helpless creatures being electrocuted so that their pelts can be used to make fur coats.
Oh, Cindy, that's not right. Cindy, that's awful. Cindy, that's just wrong.
Interesting. Well, there you have it. Even a big strapping woodsman from Vermont thinks that it's wrong to electrocute small animals to make fur coats.
Yeah, you should trap them.
Boy, Cindy. I had fun. Email me if you get the chance. www.logger.com.com. Log on, Cindy. Log on to the logger.
Right around in this area is where I met Cindy Crawford, and I got a great big surprise for you, ladies and gentlemen, in her person. Here and now, meet, please, Cindy Crawford's sister, Mindy Crawford.
Hi. I'm Mindy Crawford, Cindy's sister. Cindy's sorry she couldn't make it today. She's off someplace exotic making 10 grand while I'm here making 50 bucks in this faux forest. You know Cindy Crawford, big star, famous supermodel. Nice boobs. She got the boobs, I got the brains. Don't worry about it. Take a look at these, Steve. Bring it in. Folk ain't buying that, are they? No, neither is Mirabella. They're buying it on 8th Avenue, though. They buy everything on 8th Avenue. What do? I odd job. Also, I volunteer in 14th Street in an AIDS hospice. I love them down there. They love me. It works. It's all about what's in your heart. It's not about the money. Cindy knows that. She's got a great heart. But when you're rich, it's easier. You know what Mindy Crawford has in her heart. Disease.
Mm-hmm.
Stevie was peeved, though. He'd been living in New York City trying to become a television actor. He'd had 3 auditions in 6 years. I'm there 45 minutes. I'm freaking guest starring on the Cindy Crawford show, you know? The cacophony that was emanating was coming from the bellerin in Lidl's belly, and it was telling us that it was time to get something to eat, and it meant now. Now, Stevie said, we ought to try eating at one of them famous New York-style delis. What does that mean, you say? New York-style deli? Well, it means not only are the people who own and run it not from New York, they ain't even from America.
My name is Alfred Gabriel.
Alfred Gabriel, nice to meet you on the logger.
Good to meet you, man.
I ain't a genius, but something tells me you weren't born in New York City.
No, I was not born in New York.
Where?
I was born in Grenada in the Caribbean.
You ain't from New York City. Where are you originally from?
Originally from Barbados.
You enjoy living here, Al?
Well, it's not really my cup of tea, but it's a rat race. But, you know, you join with the others and you just go along.
Well, you know, everybody always want to come to New York.
Okay.
Everybody always want to come.
Why do you think that is, Ivor?
Well, the thing that you hear is always the pot of gold, and, you know, outside countries always hear everything about New York. So I don't know if there's anybody that don't want to come to New York.
I was raised in Uptown Manhattan. Uh-huh. Up is called a barrio, Spanish Harlem.
New York.
Spanish Harlem.
Lifelong New Yorker?
Sure. Yeah. I was born here.
I grew up here in Spanish Harlem.
New York City, man. The NY, man.
Was that a good life for a youngster like
for
yourself?
For me, I loved it. Yeah. It was kind of rough growing up, but I loved it.
You know, it is kind of noisy and dangerous. You just got to keep a good eye on your kids.
From the age of 7, I was seeing people getting shot.
Friends of yours?
Friend of mine, people that I didn't know. For over, like, stick a cigarette?
Yeah, it was good. Not as many cars. You could have stickball games in the street. You could play all kinds of games in the street. Now, can't really hang out in the street. The kids gotta find parks to go to.
You ever think about moving out of here? No way.
I like it too much.
You do?
I might like moving to another borough, maybe, but I like New York too much.
Yeah, I love New York.
That's right. Oh, yeah. Seems like a nice enough place, but Vermont's in my heart, too.
I bet it is. I bet it's a nice town.
Got go milk cows.
Got go milk cows.
Right.
Got go milk cows.
How many people be here buying this old furniture?
Oh, 100 of people. 100 of people.
Really?
Over 500 people will be here tomorrow.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Now, this furniture ain't cheap.
Oh, they're not cheap. They got furniture ranging, like I got a pair of chairs, ranging from $20,000 to $30,000.
$30,000?
Yeah.
About it, about it?
When you about it, about it.
What's
you
that
about
mean?
It, about it.
What's that mean?
That means you about it. You
I'm about it.
It.
I'm about it, about it.
About it. He's
okay.
About it, about it.
So let's say there's a thing that rich people are all a bunch of sons of bitch. What's the story? Rich people just as good as us poor ones?
No, rich people are sons of bitch. pretty much, no, not really, not at all.
The more you spend, the more service they feel that they're entitled to, when the fact of the matter is, really, everyone's entitled to the same service, right. Whether you spend $100 or $1 million.
Right. But they're poor people that are bitches.
Yeah, but they don't come here.
What up, dogs?
What up, dogs?
What up,
so
dogs?
So, like, when there's dogs walking down the street, you just go, hey, what up, dogs?
Nah, that's your peoples.
I hear you've been to Vermont.
That's right.
What'd you do up there?
I skied. A good friend of mine taught me how to ski.
Ever been to Vermont?
Yeah, once. A while ago.
All right.
A while ago.
The boy said
that. Yeah, it was nice.
It ain't too bad up
there. But it's a little quiet for me.
Yeah, I would love to go up there. I know a few of the guys went up there before.
Yeah.
They had a good time skiing, I believe, or something like that.
Yeah.
And I want to go, but, you know, my wife.
Take it like this, and you go like this. No, you got to hold it. Like that.
Just flip it off.
Yeah.
What's the country lacking that you couldn't live up there, you know what I mean? What does that like?
Too quiet.
I mean, you know, you're used to the fast-paced living in the city.
Right.
You want to hear a little noise sometime.
Right. So what do you get here after nightfall that you wouldn't get up there specifically, in other words?
Buses, cabs.
The actual noise.
Round noise, just back and forth.
What up, dogs?
Jeez and crow.
I'm about it, about it.
Like that.
Mario, all right. They say the boys asked me to ask you why they call you Houdini.
Houdini?
Houdini.
I tend to disappear.
3, 2, 1.
Jeez and crow!
All right, that's great.
Boom, bang.
It was time for the evening's entertainment. Stevie said we was gonna have to go down to Midtown to see all the fun stuff. And to do that, we was gonna have to get on the subway and go south. I said, subway. Ain't there a bunch of half-witted hooligans on the subway? He said, yeah, we'll fit right in. Bing, boom, bing, boom.
Good evening, generous brothers and sisters. My name is Buddy, and I'm a vet.
I have HIV. My lady has HIV, and our 7-year-old child has HIV. It is a good thing I was in the Gulf War, because the toxic fumes that I've ingested have rendered me impotent, leaving me unable to impregnate and further spread this awful disease to another helpless child. I'm not a beggar, not a bum, not a thief. This is how I earn my living, and I hope and pray that you will respect that. Please join with me now as I begin this performance with a test in which you can answer in your own mind. What is the greatest nation in the world? Donation. Have a watch. Tell me when 20 minutes is up. Bing, bing. Let them off, please. Let them off. Stand clear to close and dodge, please. Who can name that tune? Hogan's Heroes. 2, 4, 6. Pick up sticks. My imitation of a trapeze guy having a bad day. A trapeze guy having a bad day. This is number 6 train to Brooklyn Bridge, 59th Street next stop. And next stop is 59th Street next. Transfer to the end of the outer shadow, the shadow of the green, shadow of the 42nd Street, and the time is square. Stand clear the closing doors, please.
Irish bar.
Yep.
So tell me that again. How come this was the good area?
Because the male prostitution neighborhood and around this whole loop and the block behind us, this block, guys used to come cruise around and pick the guys up off the street until the cops cleaned everything up. The
cops cleaned it up?
Yeah.
Well, how come you still hang here then now that it's cleaned up?
Because I became a bum.
why don't you go somewhere else?
Because this is where I grew, you know? I didn't feel like, you know, starting anything over. Because it's hard to start over, you know? It's easy to stay where you're at.
The shoe gets comfortable.
Exactly. Once you're comfortable where you're at, why move?
Well, because if you move, something might change, perhaps for the better.
Yeah. I was scared of taking that chance.
Come on, man. You ain't scared?
No.
You ain't scared?
You know that.
You ain't scared?
Yeah, I'm very bold.
I know. Well, go for it.
But trying to take my chance, but I ain't got much time left.
How much time you think you got?
No. But I guess I'm gonna do it right here.
You got? You go to the dock?
No.
You don't go to the dock?
No.
Ain't worth it, bro.
You're just gonna wait it out.
Exactly.
You own anything at all?
Nothing.
Does it hurt?
No.
Not yet.
What do you mean not yet?
Not yet.
Give me a banana.
What are you, man? Choosy.
Hey.
Beggars can't be choosers.
Irishmen always get what they want.
You like these at all?
Yeah, it's a savings for later.
What about apples?
Come on, man. I ain't got no teeth, man.
Oh, shit. That's right. So you can gum the shit out of this, man. Come on. All right, I'll leave it anyway, right?
Okay. I can throw it against the wall.
Huh?
I can throw it against the wall.
I'll be down in a couple weeks, maybe, all right?
All right.
All right, man. I'll see you then.
All right.
All right, man. Take it easy.
Thanks, man.
Thank you.
You're looking out.
Thank you. All right.
Stevie said that he wanted to go to the hoot show, or the strip show, or as they call them down there, they call them gentlemen's clubs. Same thing. Up in Barton, they call it the hog show. Stevie said that he hadn't been to one since he and Earl Mayo went up across the border to Highgate Springs the night that Club Sally burned to the ground. Well, I didn't think that I needed to go see a bunch of naked women traipsing around stage, you know. The state that I was in, what was going on between me and Sharon there. So instead, I thought I'd give the old girl a holler on the telly, fellas. I'm gonna call Sharon up. Just take a second, and I'll wait. 1-800-CALL-ATT. Just be a minute. Calling CAD. She says, thank you for calling at TNT. One ring-a-dinger. Two ring-a-dingers. Come on, Sharon. Hassle to the phone. Three ring-a-dingers. Four. She's probably bathing. Could be bathing time. Come on, Sharon, I'm in the predicament here. What time is it? F*** that. Yeah, I'll go to the hoot show with you, Stevie. Thinking about it now, I had not seen a woman other than my wife naked since my aunt used to bathe me and my cousin Millie in the washtub back when I was 5. Of course, Millie was 15 at the time. But I was curious. Minutes later, we was there. Road number 53, right off in Broadway, we was greeted by two fellers, a big guy and a midget, both wearing penguin suits and top hats. The big guy flipped the midget's top hat off. The midget caught it on his foot right side up and bellered for a tip. Little dropped 2 12-gauge shotgun shells in and we was by. The midget said, for the love of the hall, for the love of the press the pink button, the pink button. 'Twas pitch dark except in track light and chasing each other round and round on the ceiling 5 times, then down and onto the side of the wall to spell out in blue and pink neon letters, legs, diamond. Bootlegging was his business, murder was his hobby. Uh-oh. Elevator achieved, and quick as whiskey, we was scuttered off by a frizzy-haired waitress, sat down at a round table and asked what we like to drink. Nothing, we ain't thirsty, that's fine. It's a... free to get in, there's a 2-drink minimum. 2 ginger ales, that'd be good. 2 drinks apiece, Jethro. 3 ginger ales, 3 Cokes, bring them, please. She took off, got them, brought them back, set them down. That'd be $42. $42, how the hell much are they apiece? $7 apiece, $7 apiece, Jesus H. Christ, I know where you can buy boulders for 4 cents a pound. I reeled off the 42, handed it to her, but she didn't leave. She just stood there with her hand out. I said, what do you want? I'm waiting for my tip. Tip? I'll give you a tip. You want a tip? Come here. I'll give you a tip. Come here. Choke it. Give it two pulls. If it don't start, you're out of gas. Now stand there, you whoring bitch. All of this aggravation, and I had not seen one naked woman yet then. Over the loudspeaker come Angel from Brazil, Jane, Tara with a T from Tennessee, last song on the main stage, Beth, Brittany, R.A.L., next up on the bar, and Roxanne, please report to the VIP after this song. Roxanne, please see Vicky at the VIP lounge. After this song, Roxanne wanted in the VIP. Thank you. Gentlemen, settle down and arrange yourselves for tonight's feature entertainer. It's not too late to go call the wife and kids, gentlemen. Get them down here. They're not going to want to miss those. Wanting to welcome you, gentlemen, to Legs Diamond. Bootlegging was his business. Murder was his hobby. And reminding you, gentlemen, Legs Diamond employs the 100 most beautiful women in the world from all over the world. They're dancing for you, for tips, and tips only. If you ain't tipping, well, they ain't a stripping. After having appeared in over 180-minute feature films and 75 men's magazine pictorials, tonight's feature entertainer's most recent work was being named 1999 Penthouse Pet of the Year. Welcome, gentlemen, if you would, to the world-famous Legs Diamond Theater stage, Miss Lily from Philly. All of a sudden, everything was in slow motion for me. I felt like I was in a scene out of one of them Martin Scorsese movies. Then slowly and hazily, through the smoky fog, she appeared. Miss Lily from Philly. You ring my bell. You ring my bell. Ring my bell. You ring my bell. My bell. Ring a ding a ding a ding. She wanted me. I don't know how, but next thing I knew, I was up on stage dancing with Miss Lily. I didn't have nerve to look anywhere but right straight and into her eyes. Hi.
Huh?
What's your name?
Hi.
Where are you from?
You won't say that again.
Where are you from?
Vermont.
Vermont? Where's Vermont?
Down where the watermelon grows.
Watermelon doesn't grow in Vermont, does it?
No, but I like the song.
Why are you just looking in my eyes?
'Cause they're pretty.
I wish you wouldn't do that.
He'll come.
Well, 'cause you're gonna make me shy.
Well, pardon me for saying this, man, but you're up here on this stage dancing around bad naked in front of strange men you don't even know, showing off parts of your body that I ain't so goddamn sure my wife even has. Well, you may be many things in your young life, but I'll bet every nickel I'm worth and the farm, too, that one of them ain't never gonna be shy. Then suddenly, as I was staring into Miss Lily's eyes, a strange thing happened that turned into Sharon's. It's at this point in the scene, Martin Scorsese yells, "And slow-mo!" I was down off of that stage, back to our round table, where Little was entertaining 14 lap dancers. He was dancing for them.
Oh, hey.
Hi.
How you doing?
Good, how are you?
Good, thanks for being prompt.
Sure.
Head right in there. Hi.
Hi.
How you doing?
Good. How are
I'm
you?
Nerved up. You're quite beautiful.
Thank you.
They got beautiful girls up in Vermont where I'm from, but they don't ever come around looking for me.
Oh.
Yeah, not that you've been looking for me. What's your name again?
I'm Amber.
Amber, you got a last name?
Amber Paul.
Amber Paul, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Nice name. What is it that you do?
Well, I am an exotic dancer.
Exotic means what?
Well, I'm exotic, don't you think?
I can't tell you. I don't know what exotic is. I really don't.
Well, it means that I stand up on a big stage or a big pedestal and I dance topless.
Topless?
Yes.
Okay, so that's exotic. What's the difference between exotic and erotic?
Well, erotic would be something like, I don't know, it can be erotic. As much as Mayor Giuliani will allow me to be erotic, that is.
You wear anything on the bottoms?
Oh, yes.
You do?
G-string.
A G-string?
Yes, because otherwise it would be sort of a porn kind of thing or prostitution. Oh, no. This is strictly looking. Men sit and they look.
You just wear a little G-string clip. You don't have to spend too much money on wardrobe, then, apparently. You're saving money on that, aren't you?
Well, you'd be surprised because we have to be, the club wants us to be a certain way. So our dresses have to be a certain way and we have to buy them in the club. Our G-string has to be, you know, standard and we have to buy that in the club and you have to have the shoes with the big heels.
Right. So, why is that? That puts a certain amount of posture onto you, right?
Well, actually, if you want to know a little secret?
I want to know a lot of secrets.
Okay. The big heels lift your ass.
Really?
Yeah. And they make your legs look longer, and they make the girls taller. And the more we tower over the guys who are sitting down, the better it is them. Because you're looking up at all of that.
I'm sort of looking up to you right now.
You are?
Yeah. Okay. The guys, let's get to that. Now, these fellas, they come into this place. Can you give me a specific is it a general type of feller that comes in there? All different types of fellers.
It's all kinds, from the logger all the way up to political figures, all the way to rock stars, all the way to Wall Street types.
Nicest type, give me. What's the nicest type?
The nicest type would probably be someone like you.
Oh, are you just saying that?
No, I mean it.
Oh, thank you.
Because you're a gentleman. You would never disrespect a lady and try to...
How do you know that?
No, but you would never try to do something that's against the rules in the club, like, for example, touch.
No.
Or make sort of a...
Listen here now. I had a thought there. What was it, gentlemen? You're understanding that through you meeting me here for 5 minutes. That's a lot of what you do. You read these fellers, huh?
Absolutely. Instantaneously.
You're half naked in front of these guys. There's a possibilities there. How do you keep that from going into where you don't want it to go to?
Well, fortunately, there are really, really, really big men standing all around the club, like big guys. Like, you look tiny next to them.
They ain't got G-strings on,
do they? Oh, no, that would be kind of scary, because they tend to be big Italian guys.
Oh,
big stomachs and, you know.
Sweating bastards.
So if anything is sweating... Bastards, yeah. So if anything happens, they'll step in, or you can call them. But also, we are in control. We are in control there.
Because psychologically, the man is in there looking to see you naked, so he's a little man, in other words. Is that what you're saying?
No, because the rules of the club are very clear.
Oh.
It's a look. Sorry. It's okay. It's a... Got another one down here. Step on this one.
Okay, go ahead.
You got a look and no touch policy.
Don't you rub up against them? There's them things called lap dances. Don't you rub around?
We can't really rub around. We're not supposed to.
Really?
Rudy doesn't like it.
I've heard that there's rubbing around going on.
Well, you know, some of those other girls may do that, but I'm
you
known.
You don't rub around.
I'm known as a clean dancer.
Oh.
And
good.
What a clean dancer is, it's more. It's in the eyes. It's about. I don't think you have to be. You don't have to be so obvious about it.
Right.
I think seduction can be in a shoulder, or a hand, or a look.
Right.
Or, you know, just it's about acting in a way.
In the meantime, you're earning money.
Yes, I
am. What type of money? I'm not asking personal questions what you're bringing home. Is that good? You know, people go, oh, dancers are in there. That must be some pretty good okay cash.
It's all right. I mean, some of the girls do really, really well because they're doing things they shouldn't be doing.
Oh.
But I have no complaints. But as a clean dancer, there's only so much you can do. Because some girls, they do, that's what gives us a bad reputation. They do things that I would never dream of doing.
The audition for acting, like you're acting in One Life to Live or something, I know what you gotta do for that, but what do you all do? How the hell you get this job? I mean, it's obvious right here, you're fit as a fiddle and ready for love, but you gotta take your clothes right off.
Yeah, you do.
You do.
There is an audition. I actually didn't have to audition because I came through an agency.
There's dancer agencies.
Oh, absolutely. Huh. And I just had to go in there, and yes, they have to take a picture of you to see what you look like in a G-string and heels.
Right.
And then the agency sends you out. But other girls who come straight to the club have to do an audition where they come in their dress and like all done, and they do a 3-song set. And the first song you dance with your dress on, and then the second one you take your dress off and you dance the next 2 songs topless.
I'm thinking also about Lebedins. I can hardly say that. I can hardly say that word. Lebedins. Is there lesbians back? Lesbians back.
Are you talking about lesbians?
Yeah, it's hard for me to say that. I just got a all down cleft tongue.
Okay. You. There are les.
Yeah. Lesbians. Get after you back here. I ain't asking your sexual preference.
Sometimes. No. I like men.
You're straight down the road.
I'm straight down the road.
Lebanians back here. Now they
no Lebanese.
They get fiddling around with each other back here. Because if you're a Lebanian and you got a girl with breasts right in front of you hanging. You're gonna want to fiddle around.
Oh, honey, they're in Candyland. They're happy. The girls who are lesbians there are very, very happy.
What a job! You know, I'm from Vermont. Go ahead.
Sometimes the men want a 2-girl dance.
They do.
Yeah, so you'll have one standing on one side and one on the other. And again, because Rudy is very strict, we can't touch each other.
Oh, don't do that.
But it's fun. You dance a little dance with each other and dance at the same time for the guy, and he kind of gets double of everything, you know.
Sure, there's two and two, and then. Yeah. 4 and there's 2.
Oh, and
there's 20 toes.
You're a toe man?
I can be.
Yeah, I thought that
Up in Vermont, there's a wicked, we're fag friendly. Yeah, we just passed a law up in Vermont where if you're a lesbian or a gay fella, you can get married. Did you know that? This is called civil union law.
I think that's wonderful.
Green Mountain State. I call it the Guy Mountain State. Oh, you look like $1 million, and I'm not flattering you. I'm saying that. It ain't what you think of as being if I don't mind saying, a stripper. You know, are there rough-looking gals? I mean, I didn't think it would be like, yeah.
Yeah, they're, most of them are real. I'm kind of unusual.
Hard life.
Very hard,
dancing until 4 in the morning.
But it can be, it's what you do with it, too. You can go in, you know, I don't drink, so that makes it a lot easier for
Good
me.
For
I don't
you.
Do any drugs.
Listen to that.
I go in, I do my work, I'm friendly to the customers, to the management, to the girls. I make my money and I go home.
You're professional.
I'm professional, it's a job. And it has a higher purpose for me. When I'm in there and I'm dancing, I'm thinking about, okay, great, I can pay for my acting class, or I can pay for my headshots, or, you know.
Naturalness of a body is no big deal, really.
Yeah.
I had a friend of mine, just as an aside, talking about rough women. He was going up to the heifer holes up in Canada. They call them heifer holes up there. It's not rough. And he got to going out with one of them girls up there. Mm-hmm. And he said she was used up. She said that she had a twat so big around on her, you could have thrown a hay bale right in the center of it.
Really?
Yeah. You go right in there with a dustbuster and draw it right back out if you wanted to.
With a dustbuster? Well, did she have anything that needed cleaning out?
He said she'd been bred so much that she'd been offered a job driving a Pepperidge farm truck. It was rough. But you know, he got married to her.
Yeah. He must have had, you know, quite the equipment to handle all that.
He got a dozer, he got a skidder, he got nice equipment.
Yeah.
John Deere's, most of them. Well, you're right, he has good equipment. Breasts that are not real, they have them, they're fake. I've never been around them because I'm with milk cows and they don't do fake teaching.
No.
I don't want to ask nothing personal and I don't even want to look when I ask, but you ain't got them fake breasts, do you?
Are you kidding me?
No, I mean, I don't know, because I wouldn't know what to wear.
The fake ones stand way up here.
They do.
Or they stand way out here.
Well,
and sometimes
standard.
They're kind of opposite. Some horrible surgeries. Horrible surgeries I've seen. Big scars. It's really kind of sad.
Really?
And it's like, if those things come at you, you're going down. Like, you walk through the door, big man, and those...
I'm going down.
But mine are real.
I take my chances at going down.
you wouldn't get back up. You'd have 2 black eyes.
Yeah.
So mine are real, though.
They are.
Yeah. You want to see?
I wouldn't mind.
Are you? Yeah. I want you to know that they're certifiable. Think you can handle it?
I shouldn't look, should I? I ain't gonna look.
You can look. This is what I do. It's fine. Are you nervous?
A little bit. I'm a Green Mountain boy.
Yeah, you are. Yeah. Well, these are not Green Mountains. They're more like Freckled Mountains. So what do you think?
I've been in a few barns in my day, but I tell you what, I mean,
they pass.
They pass.
That's good.
I ain't getting anywhere near him, though. I'd like to touch him, but not right in the hubcap. Right on the side, maybe. I don't know.
You're not a hubcap man.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you are a hubcap man?
Yeah. I sell hubcaps.
You do?
Yeah.
Well, there's some plastic surgeons who sell them as well.
Now, is this, I'm not saying it's a good job to have and you treat it quite nicely, but is this a job that if your daughter come running to you, I'm dancing in the club in New York City, Mom.
Well, it depends on how old she is, too. I mean, I made the choice as an adult. Hmm. I don't think I would stop my daughter from doing it, but I would certainly talk to her about how to handle yourself. And it's a job. It's not your life. It's not your identity.
Right.
And that's what people confuse. They think, oh, well, you're a stripper, therefore your mentality is all about drugs and money and sex. And it's like, no, some women are in there taking care of their kids when their man walked out on them. Or they're getting their PhD. There's a woman getting her PhD, and she's paying for it.
So you hear that, but you don't believe it. But I tell you what, seeing you, you can believe it. Look at the brightness of your eyes and your soul. I mean, it's interesting. I appreciate you coming. I tell you what. I got some time, you know.
Two freckles past a hair?
Two freckles past a hair. Look at that freckles on me.
Damn.
You like that?
Wow, look at that.
Quite an hair.
Yeah.
Yours.
It's more like my leg there.
I like that hair. You're quite rugged. You know, I can make my muscle burn.
Yeah, watch sure.
Oh, God. Excuse me. I was gonna ask you, I don't check my fun situation here.
Yeah.
Well, you wouldn't mind going out and having a something to eat with me, maybe? I'm here in the city just traipsing around.
Yeah, I'd love to.
I can't believe I got
nerve. You're quite a gentleman.
Can't believe I got nerve. I've got some money here, because I'll treat you pretty good out there, and we'll get something to eat.
Dancing for them. I grabbed him by the scruff of the neck, Stevie. We hit that elevator down and onto the sidewalk, and we was gone. You know, when springtime comes to the mountains, it can make you feel like you just barely come right out of the womb. Well, I'm here to tell you that when summertime hits stride in the city, it can make you feel like you just barely come right out of the womb, you know. Got back to Stevie's apartment, and I was glad to be inside and out from the city. And it was nice, not so hot. And I was nervous about stuff and tired. Stevie knew that and offered me his room, just a mattress on the floor with a fan at the foot of it. I dropped my drawers off and flopped myself smack ass down onto that mattress. Stevie said I might hear his roommate coming in a little bit later on. He told me he'd been sharing with a real tall, pretty model girl, but I said, Stevie, don't worry about it. I'm so tired. I'm gonna be out so cold, ain't nothing gonna wake me, but I was wrong. What Stevie didn't tell me is that he and his pretty model roommate are sleeping partners. And what Stevie forgot is that when she gets home around 11 o'clock at night, she walks right into his room, puts her jewelry on the bureau, takes her bra off, hangs it on the mirror, affixes her panties just so, and flops herself smack ass down onto that mattress next to him. This time next to me with the fan oscillating at my feet, and every time it goes by, my drawers blow up. Giving her ample access for all kinds of deeds, so every time they blow up, I try to blow them down, you know. Didn't bother her none. She thought I was Stevie snoring, so she puts her arm and leg over me, you know, the way they do all the time, you know. Well, now I'm a 38-year-old married man, laying there in the dark by myself, not trying to bother anybody, having all the fun I need to have with the fan, really. But I got a half-naked, young, attractive, tall, pretty model woman flailed all over me. I wanted to tell you that it was starting to get damp in that room. What I mean to say is that the air was becoming increasingly more and more heavily laden with humdiddy. The heat in degree day units was peaking. Please allow me to admit that pollination was in the back of my mind. However, as tempting as the situation was, I realized, like the honey bee, if I'd have stuck my stinger in her, I'd been dead once I flew home. So So I did that get me off me, shake me off me thing you do there, you know, in my best Stevie imitation. I got up, he got up, bolted into Stevie's room, woke him up. He took one look at my excitement and said, it's the Empire State Building. I gotta take you up the Empire State Building, and it was the Empire Building, stood some 1,300 feet and into the air, 81 stories to the observation deck, and it took two elevators and an escalator to get there. Tonight, it was lit in white, bright lights, though the top couple tiers that jog in are often lit special, according to season and certain holiday. Christmas, they fire it red and green. 4th of July, red, white, and blue. Frank Sinatra's birthday, it's all blue. During sugaring season, it's gray day, medium amber. Well, we got to the top, and after I'd purchased some Dramamine at the gift store for the trip down, we stepped foot out onto the observation deck. I was startled. The electrical wiring that goes into this town astounds me. How do they heat these buildings, Stevie? Everybody shits. Everybody's got a bunch of garbage. Where the hell they put all that? Huh, I can't believe that. That's Lady Liberty standing right over there. What the hell, huh? Lady Liberty. The French Canadians give her to us. Is them the world's trade towers right now, huh? Christ, they're tall, aren't they? Oh, this is something else. You know that breeze blowing in my face there? That sky up above me that I ain't even feeling up nothing ahead of me up in there. I could almost be standing on my deck up to home. With no difference. As people down there, them people, they just trying to make bot just like me, ain't they? They ain't bad. They're just different, that's all. Different ain't bad. Little's different. Stevie, thank you for bringing me up here. This is quite grandiose. Really, I'm quite enthralled. I feel 1,000,000%, you know. I have monopoly running through me right now, really. And if I was any better feeling, they'd clone my ass. You know who'd love this too, and I'm telling you, Sharon would love it. I'm gonna holler to her on the phone. Stevie, we're getting out of here. Huh? Yeah, right off. Me and Little Bo, we're going. No, I like it. It's something else. Yeah, we're just getting out right off. Yep. Sharon! I bought you a Lady Liberty, you know. All in all, though, the
Trip to New York was a fun trip. Had a good time. Nice place. Learned a lot. I wouldn't want to live there, you know. The toll that you pay is not worth what they offer you. For me, anyways. Maybe not, you know. Little moved down. Yeah, he's living down there. He's got a job working the door at Legs Diamond. Yeah, he loves it. He's living with Miss Lily from Philly. Yeah. They're living together, romantically involved. I guess the story goes one night after work, they got to visiting there, you know, come to find out she's got a three-legged dog. Yeah. So between the both of them, they got two dogs, four legs total, you know. And would you not believe that they both took up to acting and they've gotten to be casted in the same production of The Sound of Music off and off and off and off in Broadway there somewhere, you know. And Little plays the captain and Maria, you know, Lily plays Maria, and they're getting wicked good reviews. Little, I guess he's quite the ad-libber. He sung one night, he sung, raindrops on roses and whiskers on kittens. God damn it, Maria, I cannot find my middens. You know, he's just ad-libbing. Yeah. You laugh. But they're happy. They're happy. Me, I'm back up here. Living here alone, you know. It ain't bad. It ain't good. Yeah, but life goes on, you know, and you tend to think about it, and you 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 tend to think about it, and you think about it, and you think about it. You think about it all the time. I miss Little. You get down road number 53 right off in Broadway and you see a little fella. He got them little eyes, little teeth, little bit of hair up on top of his head, sticks up a little. You go right over to him. Tell him that you know me and tell him I said hi, really, and give him a great big tip. And don't leave without haunching down and giving Craig a pat for me, would you? I'd appreciate that. Should have left her that note. She come by two nights ago, took everything out. Goddamn Grinch couldn't have done a better job.
Hey, fellas. What are you doing over there? Ho, now, ho, and a merry old man. Get him out of there. Leonardo, drowning on you. Get old Rose, she'll get him out of there. Old Kate Winslet, she'll get him right up out of there. And then she'll leave him. Statistics say that, the odds are for that. Old Rose, Washington Square. The logger's looking for love. New York City. Looking for love.
She got the good running car. She's letting me live in the house that I built. You know, shell that it is. Do not pass go. Do not collect 200. That's all right. I started out with nothing. I got most of it left.
What'd it cost to get in here? $10? $10? Well, my watch says your $10 is up. Anybody out there feel they got gypped or anything, feel that they didn't get enough show, you're welcome to stay around after. I'll get the drum back out. I want to thank the Virgin's Opera House and the people that work there, Jerry Ann Smart. Got Elizabeth and Marty on the lights, doing a hell of a job. No, don't clap yet. Peter Sutherland. What's your names? Huh? Well, they put the chairs up. I'd like to thank the community of Virgins and the outlying communities, and the Logger Tour would like to thank the whole state of Vermont for supporting it very much. Thank you very much. You know, they say to be a real Vermonter that you have to be third generation. Well, I ain't third generation. I ain't a real Vermonter, but there's a poem that I know that I like. It talks to me about how I feel. It was written by a feller by the name of Vrest Orton. V-R-E-S-T, Orton, O-R-T-O-N. He was a friend of Robert Frost's, and they wrote poetry together. In fact, Vrest started the Vermont, I don't know what the hell Fred did, but Vrest started the Vermont Life magazine, and the Vermont Country Store is still in the Orton family to this day. I wonder if you like it. Vermont. Of course it's my state. I don't know whether I adopted Vermont or whether Vermont adopted me. Either way is just as good. I'm rooted in. Thanks for coming. If you see me on the road, running the road in my pickup, flag me down, wave me over. I'd love to have a visit with you. That's the end of the show. You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here.
When you see me dress up in my Sunday evening clothes, I'm going down where the watermelon grows.
Ain't nobody better than you, Al.
No, I try sometimes, you know.
Going to have the lunch here at the what they call the Sutton place. I have the bagel and fluff a bagel, you might say. Cabbage cheese, good to eat. The birds will eat that, don't worry about it. The cheese. I am Fermin Le Poisson, your friend, number one logger in the world. I am. Look at the boat.
Hey there! Hey ya! Greetings from the Green Mountain State!
I almost choked on that goddamn thing. Ugh.
Gotta get one of them for the cows. One of them for the house. I don't need one of them.